From the Old Testament, Isaiah 61, 1 through 6. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me. Because the Lord has anointed me, he has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and release to the prisoners. To proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit. They will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord to display his glory. They shall build up the ancient ruins. They shall rise up the former devastations. They shall repair the ruined cities, the devastations of many generations. Strangers shall stand and feed your flocks. Foreigners shall till your land and dress your vines. But you shall be called priests of the Lord. You shall be named ministers of our God. You shall enjoy the wealth of the nations, and in their riches you shall glory. And from Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 12 through 21, and also 26 through 27. For just as the body is one, and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. Indeed, the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot would say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear would say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole body were hearing, then where would the sense of smell be? But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them, as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many members, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again to the head, to the feet, I have no need of you. If one member suffers, all suffer together with it. If one member is honored, all rejoice together with it. Now you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. And from Luke 4, 14 through 21. Then Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee, and report about him spread through all the surrounding country. He began to teach in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. When he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent to me to proclaim release to the captives and to recover of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing."
Grace to you and peace from God, our Heavenly Father, and His Son, Jesus Christ, our blessed Lord. Choir, I can go back and sit down now. Because that truly is the point of today's message. We can build a bridge of peace and harmony. People of God, what a week it has been. For me, it started out magnificently. I got to finally meet my granddaughter. Annabelle is as cute as a button. I am glad to report she is perfect in every way. Then I came back to church and immediately was struck by the sadness of Hugh Halsey's death and ministered along with our good associate here to the family as they began that grief process. And we planned an upcoming funeral. And then all the events and organizational issues of the church were falling upon us in the office and starting to work and try to complete the annual report while we all have our own personal issues and dynamics. On Friday, I, like so many of you, joined in watching the inauguration of President Trump and Vice President Pence, listening to the language, the rhetoric, the speeches, looking at the splendor and the celebration, and then also being impressed by some of the rioting, by alleged anarchists smashing things and just being violent and negative. It didn't take long, though, once the president was inaugurated, for that crescendo to swell into a rancor of critique and criticism and counter-criticism, and here we go again, back and forth, forth and back. And then, of course, yesterday, there was the march, the Women's March. 500,000 women in Washington, D.C., projected 2 million women gathering all around the world to speak their message of concern for the treatment and care in regard of women. What a week we have been through. It has been a time of rancor and turmoil and continuing turbulence. Today I just hope that you hear the prayer and the message of the choir, that we can build a bridge of peace and harmony. It won't be easy. It won't be easy. But we can build a bridge of peace and harmony. I chose this week because it parallels the week from when we had that snowstorm last year to launch this bulletin. I think it was kind of unconscious of me. It's just falling in the liturgical year at the same time. And so the lessons that we have before us today are actually from last year. I had no intentionality when I did this except to save a few dollars. Isn't it interesting how God works? That the scriptures that would have been read a year ago are read for us today. And that the gospel that comes before us is this. Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit, and news about him spread through the whole countryside. He was teaching in their synagogues, and everyone praised him. He went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day he went to the synagogue, as was his custom. He stood up to read, which meant that he was acknowledged as a great teacher. So he stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Then he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him. And he began by saying to them, "Today the scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." As I did my work exegeting and studying the scripture, I opened a commentary. I cannot make this stuff up. I opened a commentary, and the commentator said, this passage is Jesus' inaugural address. Okay, Lord, I get it. You know, in the midst of all of the inaugural addresses and counter-addresses and critique and criticism, the executive orders, all the things that are happening in the world around us, it's important for us not to get caught up in all of the verbiage, except to occasionally pause and say, and what was Jesus' inaugural address? We're Christian people. What is the inaugural address of Jesus that he calls us to follow him in being about and in doing? The inaugural address is right here. It begins with his being. He says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. It's a statement of being. It's a statement of connection to God through the Holy Spirit. Jesus claims his station and his being because the Spirit of the Lord is upon him. He is so intimately connected with God, there is no deviation from where God goes and starts and where he ends. There is that profound glue of the Holy Spirit holding him together with God the Father. We too, as we receive the agenda of Jesus Christ, we too, as we receive this address, must first and foremost be a people of prayer, a people of the Holy Spirit, a people asking God to come upon us in the Holy Spirit to guide and direct our ways, to lead us and our feet, to keep us on God's agenda and path. The Lord's Spirit is upon me. He has anointed me, poured out his holy oil upon me to pray, proclaim good news to the poor. The poor is the focus. The poor in every regard, whether it's a poverty of not having goods and nutrition and substance, or a poverty of spirit, or a poverty of soul, we are anointed to proclaim good news to the poor. And then he delineates the mission. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, and to proclaim the Jubilee year, the year of the Lord's favor. It is as simple as that. He proclaims liberty, freedom, life full and abundant, spiritual life beginning now and continuing through eternity, life that fills your heart with joy even in the midst of adversity. I ask myself, how could he so succinctly state this address of his? Oh yes, it is redacted from the prophet Isaiah. It is what was foretold. It was what was promised. But how did he so quintessentially sum it up to stay connected to God through the Holy Spirit and to be about care for the poor, the oppressed, the blind, and to make a year of justice? That's what the year of the Lord's favor is about. And I remember
He was conceived by the Holy Ghost. When he was baptized, the previous chapter, the Holy Spirit comes and alights on him. This same Spirit, after the baptism, does what? Drives him out into the wilderness to be tested by Satan. There, tested by Satan, Satan comes to him and says, "Turn that stone into bread." And he says, "Man doesn't live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." He takes him up to a high place and says, "Cast yourself down, for the scripture says," yes, Satan quotes scripture, "the scripture says that he will give his angels charge of you." And Jesus says, "Don't put your Lord, your God, to the test." He says, "Bow down and worship me. Be a narcissist, be filled with ego, and I'll give it all to you." And Jesus says, "You will worship the Lord your God in him only." Jesus comes to this statement, this inaugural address, constantly led by the Spirit throughout the entirety of his life. He comes to this inaugural address by facing turbulence, by facing trauma, by facing testing, and by saying no to Satan and yes to God. Isn't that the task of a Christian? In all the rhetoric, in all the complexity, in all of the upheaval that we experience in our lives, maybe a simple rule is to say, "I want to be connected to God by the Holy Spirit. I want to say no to Satan, and I want to say yes to everything that God wants me to be and do." Simple as that. Yesterday I had a Presbyterian committee meeting. It was held down in Emmaus. It was a joint meeting of Philadelphia and Lehigh Presbytery, the camp committee. Left the house about 8. Meeting started about 10. Went for many, many hours till 3:30, and I felt deep fried. We talked about the governance of the camp. We talked about policy and procedures. We talked about budget. We talked about assets. We talked about needed improvements. We talked about pending loans. We talked about personal policies, camping policies, all that complexity. What was interesting was that I sat next to two young women colleagues, two pastors. And as we were chatting during a break, the one gal said to the other gal, "How long have you been ordained?" And she said, 3 years. And then she said to the other gal, "How long have you been ordained?" 2 years. And then they said to me, "How long have you been ordained?" I said, 40 years. And the one gal looked at me and went, "Whoa." And then began to explain, no, I was just surprised. I mean, you're still doing it. Yeah, things are good. And then she said, "So was this meeting any different from the kinds of meetings that you had 40 years ago?" Good question. And the answer was not in the process, the tedium, the procedure, the intricacy, and the exhaustion. But the issues are changing. They are changing with the times. They are, in some ways, for this old man, complex. They are things that I never thought I'd be really trying to deal with. But that doesn't make it bad. It makes it very good. For example, what do you do with transgender students who come to camp? Interesting topic. Another question that came up during the day was during another break out in the hallway, a fairly young man, actually a very young man, said to me, "Did you see Reverend So-and-So's shirt?" I'm sitting next to her. I said, "Yeah." So what do you think?
She's really attentive to that kind of thing. And he said, but what about the shirt? Worked well with the outfit. Where are you taking me on this? And he said, well, don't you know what was on the shirt? I said, a design. And he said, well, Ed, the design is a computer-generated symbol signifying a lady's part. 40 years! And I said, oh! The world is changing. Not really in process, but in topic. Yeah, I didn't want to say the part, okay? But I think that what Jesus lays out for here, for us here in this inaugural address, is the tried and true. Be connected to the Holy Spirit of God. Say no to Satan. Say yes to where Jesus Christ leads you in what he calls us to do as we follow him. It's just that simple. To God be the glory. Amen.